And in this session, we have advocacy groups and representative organisations. And first of all, we have Parents for Choice, and Sinead Redmond will speak on behalf of Parents for Choice. And we have an additional guest here as well. That's Thionól, and she's 16 months old. I don't think she'll have anything to say. And next we have Every Life Counts, and Tracy Harkin is going to speak on behalf of Every Life Counts. Then we have the representative organisation, Irish Family Planning Association, and Dr. Katrina Hinchian will speak on behalf of that organisation. And finally, we have Family and Life, and Patrick Carr will speak on behalf of Family and Life. And just to remind the speakers, I don't know whether they were here when I was sort of laying down the law earlier, twice before or three times before this morning, you have 10 minutes to speak, and Sharon will press the button when there's only 1 minute left. And I'm just asking you all to finish within the 10 minutes, because we have terribly difficult time constraints. Thank you very much. So we'll have Sinead first.
Hi everyone, thanks for inviting us here today. I'm Sinead Redmond from Parents for Choice. I'm a mother of two children, one of whom you've seen already. The other one is four and agreed to stay at home. Thionól is 16 months and has stronger ideas about where her rightful place was. And it's just as well the speech today is only 10 minutes, because I don't think she's ever allowed me to speak for 10 minutes uninterrupted before. So we'll see how that goes. So Parents for Choice, who are Parents for Choice in Pregnancy and Childbirth Ireland, we originated as a Facebook group set up in 2013 to discuss issues around choice and autonomy in pregnancy and childbirth. And we developed into a campaigning group in the aftermath of the case of Ms. Y in 2014. Our purpose is to provide a platform for parents to inform ourselves and to campaign on issues surrounding reproductive rights, maternity care and abortion in a family-friendly and accessible manner. So this is some of us. I'm here today to communicate three important messages to you on our behalf. Firstly, I will highlight how the Eighth Amendment disproportionately impacts on us as parents in choosing when and how to grow our families. Secondly, I'll discuss how the Eighth Amendment affects us even when we choose to continue pregnancies. And finally, I will highlight a very important concern for us as parents, that unless the Eighth Amendment is repealed, it will negatively impact on our children as they grow into young adulthood. 54% of those who need access to abortion are already mothers and parents. We are best placed in knowing the reality of the work and commitment of having a child. We love our children. We make all of our decisions, including our reproductive ones, in their best interests. There are many reasons why a parent might choose to have an abortion. Maybe she's already living in poverty and deprivation with her existing children. Maybe she's in a dangerous home environment. Maybe there were health risks to the mother in previous pregnancies and she doesn't want to risk her existing children losing their mother. Maybe she knows she doesn't have the capacity to parent more children well. Or maybe she had previous postnatal mental health issues. All of these reasons are valid. Only the woman or her family will experience and understand the factors driving these reasons, and only they will have to live with the outcome of their choices. The number of women who have needed to self-administer with the abortion pill who have contacted me, needing the support of a listening ear, continues to rise. Each time I listen to them and tell them about their options, I make myself liable to 14 years in jail. For context, the maximum sentence for rape in Ireland is 10 years. Standing here talking about this to you is incriminating myself. Each time I talk to them, I have to make sure that they know, even though they've made up their mind, and that this is the safest, easiest, and most appropriate course of action for them, they are becoming liable to 14 years in jail for making this decision. And usually they already have existing children whom the sentence would render motherless, so they have to be really careful about being caught. We are parents. We know the reality of parenting in Ireland. how challenging it can be and how it can limit our ability to access, to partake equally in society. Some of the biggest barriers include recent cuts to lone parents' allowance when 60% of lone parent families already live in poverty and deprivation. The highest childcare costs in Europe, a homelessness crisis affecting thousands of families, and a lack of supports and services for families raising children with extra needs. Tawn's trying to make herself heard there, I don't know if you can hear her. For those parents experiencing such disadvantages, the eighth is even more cruel. It disproportionately affects poor women and women from other countries. The option to travel is not an option for everyone. Costs include flights, other travel, accommodation, the medical procedure itself, and often childcare. Women who cannot afford to travel and are unwilling or unable to take abortion pills purchased online are forced to have babies whether it is the right time for them or not. If they are already having financial difficulties or living in poverty, it will seriously impact on their existing family, putting them at increased risk of poverty and disadvantage over their lifetime. Parents living in direct provision centres who receive €19.10 a week have no chance of saving enough to access an abortion if they do not wish to grow their family. All of these parents must then take legal abortion pills and face 14 years in jail, continue a pregnancy that they feel will hurt themselves or their family, or take action to end the pregnancy in a high risk or harmful way. We at Parents for Choice feel that this is unacceptable. But the Eighth Amendment is bigger than the issue of abortion. Ireland is not the safest place in the world to have a baby. The claims that the Eighth protects women and babies are a complete myth. As the Association for the Improvement in the Maternity Services, AIMS Ireland, frequently point out, there are 25 countries who have maternal mortality rates lower than Ireland. The maternal mortality rate is the measure of how many women die from pregnancy and childbirth in the postpartum period from those direct causes. 19 of those countries are in Europe. There are also numerous problems with how Ireland as a country gathers our data on this rate, which means that the reported rate is a serious underestimation of what's actually happening. Even when we choose to remain pregnant, we also experience a lack of basic services, like an anomaly scan, that very important scan at 20 weeks that tells us how healthy our pregnancy is, which is standard across the entire rest of the EU. The facilities pregnant women and people are forced to attend remain substandard. There aren't even enough beds, with no apparent intention of improving them anytime soon. There are also financial penalties of needing extra care and medication during pregnancy. In my last pregnancy, I was on life-saving medication, which I would have died without, and it cost me over €1,000 during the course of my pregnancy, a not insignificant sum. The reason I was on this medication was that my pregnancy became life-threatening at 13 weeks when I developed pulmonary embolisms, which are a leading cause of maternal death during pregnancy in Ireland. I chose to continue that pregnancy, this is the outcome, at my own risk. I would support any other woman, any other family in making a different choice. It is my life and my family at risk and my call and only mine to make. The Eighth Amendment restricts our choices in continued pregnancy and birth. Both the HSE's National Consent Policy and the HICWA National Standards for Safer, Better Maternity Services specifically note that pregnant women cannot legally have the final choice in consent and refusal over their own bodies, instead citing the High Courts as the appropriate decision-making body. Nobody with full capacity to make the choice should be denied the right to choose whether or not to consent to any surgery, intervention, medication or treatment, and yet, in Ireland, this is the case if you are pregnant. The AIMS Ireland What Matters to You survey from 2014 found that only 50% of women in labour and birth were given the opportunity to make an informed refusal of a test, procedure or treatment, meaning that half of all birthing women in Ireland had no say in what was done to their bodies during labour and birth. A repeal of the Eighth Amendment would open the door for us to access abortion services where we live, when we need to, and also ensure that we have the final say in what it's done to our bodies during pregnancy or birth. Mother A and Ms. B are both women who were dragged through the High Courts by maternity hospitals when heavily pregnant, rather than have their right to informed consent or refusal respected in their choice of birth, as would have happened in every other country in the EU. Most women don't make it as far as the courts, with the threat of being coerced in such a manner, along with the threat of social services involvement with their existing children being enough to coerce them into compliance. Many of us in Parents for Choice have experienced this firsthand, and the traumas that we have endured as a result have seriously impacted our health and our decisions on whether to have more children in this country. We would also like to take this opportunity to highlight that we have been contacted by parents of children with extra needs, in particular Down syndrome, who have joined Parents for Choice on foot of how they feel their children have been used in this debate by those who oppose abortion access in all circumstances. We attached in our submission, which I think you have in front of you, how some of those parents feel in their own words, all of whom condemn the co-opting of stories of people with disabilities to further political ends. Finally, as parents, especially parents of daughters, we cannot understand how any potential future life could be considered more important than their lives. Our children in existence are who we love and cherish. We don't hold potential future grandchildren above the rights, choices, and lives of our own children. We at Parents for Choice call for a total repeal of the Eighth Amendment. Even if the Eighth Amendment were repealed tomorrow, we would have very, very limited access to safe and legal abortion, only if we were on the point of death, as the Protection of Life During Pregnancy Act would still apply. But the Constitution, as a blunt instrument, is not the appropriate place to make personal, often knife-edge medical decisions. Legislators and politicians making blanket rules, regardless of circumstances, dangerously interfere in our rights to privacy in family life, health, and our own lives. As parents, we make decisions that we hope will improve our children's chances, their well-being, and their happiness. If we become pregnant and do not wish to remain pregnant, it's because we know it's currently not in the best interests of our family or ourselves. No contraception is 100% effective. The majority of those who are seeking abortion access were using contraception. We feel that the best thing for children and society are parents who are supported and willing, and that sometimes abortion is the right choice. The Eighth Amendment is damaging to children, to parents, and anyone experiencing pregnancy, including those who wish to continue it. We believe that a repeal of the Eighth Amendment would spare a great deal of pain and doubt to many. Trust women, trust parents. We want to repeal the Eighth Amendment, and we ask each and every one of you to join with us in our aim to achieve that. Thank you for your time and listening.
Thank you, Sinead, and thank you, Ethan, for being so good. And now we'll hear from Tracy Harkin on behalf of Every Life Counts. You won't have a distraction.
Hello, everyone. My name is Tracy Harkin, and I'm here today because of how my own personal experience has impacted on my understanding of babies with life-limiting conditions, and also because I know, like many, many parents in our support network across Ireland, that no disability, no matter how severe, should diminish the right to life of any child. So just an overview of what I want to talk with you about today. So we're talking about babies with a severe disability. That's what we're talking about. So we're not talking about a fatal abnormality. These babies are alive and kicking at the time of diagnosis. Is there something wrong with the PowerPoint? Okay. So these babies are alive and kicking at the time of diagnosis, and we believe deserving of the same right to life as any other baby. Research shows that abortion in these circumstances is hugely distressing for mothers too. And what we want above all is best care for families, both mother and baby, when baby's life might be very short, and we passionately believe that this care is a pathway to healing where abortion is not. So this is my little girl, Kathleen Rose, if we can get to see her here. Kathleen has trisomy 13. Yeah, it's just not. Yeah. So this is my little daughter, Kathleen, who is trisomy 13, and this condition is usually diagnosed in the womb, and it's often misleadingly described as a fatal fetal abnormality. Trisomy 13 is a serious life-limiting condition. but Kathleen has surprised everyone and brought us great joy and happiness. She's really made us better parents and better people. And I really believe that children like Kathleen and all children can teach us how to love. Kathleen now is 10 years old. So as you may know, research indicates that a large majority of Irish parents who find out that their preborn babies have a life-limiting condition do not have an abortion and do continue to carry their babies. One 2013 study from Cork University Maternity Hospital found that more than 90% of parents did not have an abortion after a diagnosis of trisomy 13, for example. While another study published in 2015 found that almost 80% of parents did not have an abortion after a diagnosis of a neural tube defect, including anencephaly or spina bifida. And this corresponds to Dr. Peter McFarlane's evidence here in the Assembly in January, when he said that the vast majority of parents in these situations do not undergo an abortion. But we rarely get to hear the voices of these parents, so we wanted to take some time to share what they have to say to you today. So this is Aileen, whose baby Lillianne lived for 6 days after birth with anencephaly. And Aileen says that when you're told you're going to get nothing, to get 6 days is just a miracle. I'm so proud of her that she lived for 6 days. She was held and loved by everyone. If our love could have saved you, you would have lived forever. And that's little Vicky Wall talking about her daughter, Layden, who had trisomy 18. I hope we get some of these images up here because I think they just speak volumes. That's little baby Layden. And then we have Maya, who lived for 1 hour and 13 minutes after she was born. And that time, her mother says, will be etched in my heart, mind, and soul forever. She was alive and kicking in my womb and was adamant that she wanted to come and meet us. And that's Kira Connery, her mommy, speaking about her little baby Maya. And Mandy O'Neill's baby daughter, Cara, was diagnosed with trisomy 7. I hope we can get some of these images up here. Yeah, can you do it a bit quicker? Yeah, they're all there. So that's little baby Maya with trisomy 7. And then we have Mandy O'Neill's daughter, Cara, who was diagnosed with trisomy. And Mandy says, it's very profound what Mandy said. She said, I'm so glad my body was her safe haven for those 38 weeks. It was her home. She knew nothing but love in our time together. And then we have little Sean Hines, who lived for 2 days after birth with trisomy 18. And his mother, Sarah, tells us, she says, we wrapped him in love for those 2 days, two wonderful days we will never forget. He's made us better people, and for that we are forever grateful. And next we have little baby Mark, Carmel's baby son, who was diagnosed again with anencephaly. And she says, I'm the mother of a dead baby. I know that terrible and ravishing pain. Our greatest comfort now, in the face of what was an undeniable tragedy, is that we didn't hurt him and he didn't hurt us. Next, we have Tanya Coonan's baby girl, Lily, who lived for 2 hours with anencephaly. And Tanya says, her imperfections are beautiful to me. I'm blessed to have seen her beautiful face and touched her tiny hand. Next, we have Mandy Dunn's little girl, Murin, who lived for 6 weeks with trisomy 13. And Mandy says, Murin was born with two fists in fighting position, ready to take on the world. She made a huge impact on us all. And little Grace Sharp is next, whose little girl Lily Joy lived for 4 hours after birth with trisomy 18. And her mum says it gives her great comfort to know that she can look back and know that she did everything she could to make sure that little Lily knew she was loved. So next we want to look at the label, the fetal abnormality label that we hear so much about. So firstly, you can see how valued and important these little babies are to their parents. And that's just a small sample of the parents in our support network. And that's why I really must take issue with the Assembly's decision to use that hurtful and misleading term, fatal fetal abnormality. It's hurtful and misleading because no doctor can say how long a baby with a life-limiting condition will live beyond birth. Because the term is not found in any medical textbook, because research shows that these babies do live beyond birth, even with the most severe condition, anencephaly. Because the medical literature says the phrase is misleading, and should not be used in counselling. And it's important to know that the HSC here recently, having researched the subject and consulted with families throughout Ireland, used the correct term life-limiting condition in its new 2016 New Standards of Bereavement Care. So next, these are babies with a severe disability. There is no evidence that they suffer any pain in the womb because of their condition, and any pain after birth is managed with good palliative care. It's simply dreadful, we believe, to single out these babies for abortion because of their disabilities, and it's a form of discrimination that wouldn't be accepted in any other area. However short their lives, our children's lives and all children's lives have value and meaning, just as much as yours or mine. So next, I want to look at the whole idea of choice when choice becomes an expectation. And we don't have to look very far to see where this has happened. In most countries where abortion is legalised, the majority of babies with a life-limiting condition are aborted. This lethal discrimination also extends to other less severe conditions, as we now know, with 100% of babies with Down syndrome, for example, being aborted before birth in Iceland. So the reality is that choice soon becomes an expectation, with many parents telling us that negative attitudes can really cause them pressure to abort when that diagnosis is given. And there's another reality to this discussion that's all too often ignored, where a life-limiting condition is diagnosed, and that it's usually a late-term abortion. The baby receives a lethal injection into the heart, and the mother then has to give birth to a dead baby. A new study found that mothers are significantly more likely to suffer depression and despair when undergoing an abortion after a diagnosis of anencephaly, where in contrast, parents in this study who carried their babies to term report experiencing great love despite their loss and find the time together is a pathway to healing. So there is a better alternative to abortion, and it's called perinatal hospice care. Perinatal, the word just means around the time of birth. And it's a model of compassionate care that begins right from the time of diagnosis. It means continuity of care so that women can see the same medical team throughout their pregnancy. It also means providing factual information so that parents are properly informed about the condition being diagnosed. It also means providing bereavement midwives and counsellors and ensuring that necessary medical support is provided throughout the pregnancy and at birth. So for example, parents will be encouraged to draw up a birth plan, and the hospital ensures that when baby is born, the family have their own room, that family can be open to family, extended family members, so that everyone can come to see the baby. And a specialist photographer, such as Now Lie Me Down to Sleep, can be arranged, as well as a chaplain if desired. So this care gives parents above all the gift of time with their baby. And when you're told that your child may not have very long, that time becomes all important. As one mother so poignantly and powerfully told us, you learn to pour a lifetime of love into those hours or days. So parents tell us of the joy that they experienced for those moments of finally holding the baby in their arms after all the stress of the pregnancy, of sharing their child's life for those brief moments with family members who came to say hello and goodbye, and of how proud they were of their little babies, of the love and joy that they shared in those moments. And of course, some children, like my own daughter, Kathleen Rose, who's now 10, do go on to defy all expectations. And anecdotal evidence suggests, of course, that misdiagnosis can also occur. So I'd like to add that if abortion is legalised on grounds of disability, the baby's right to life is taken away because of that disability, and the law changes culture. We would be creating a class of human beings who are less equal before the law than others, and that would be a huge step backwards for children's rights, but for particular for the rights of disabled persons. So finally, we believe that better care, perinatal hospice care, is a progressive and compassionate answer for families devastated by the news that their baby has a life-limiting condition. Abortion is not a pathway to healing. Love for both mother and baby, support for both mother and baby, compassion for both mother and baby is a pathway to healing. We in this country can do much better than abortion. So let Ireland be an example to the world. Let us hold up at the best model of care possible when parents get this terrible news that their baby's life may be all too short. and I would urge this Assembly not to repeal the Eighth Amendment. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much, Tracy. We'll now hear Dr. Catriona Henchian on behalf of the Irish Family Planning Association.
Thanks. Thank you for inviting me to speak here today. The IFPA feels that women's healthcare experience in Ireland when it comes to unplanned pregnancy falls far below Irish healthcare standards in all other areas and indeed international healthcare standards. There are clinical risks to patient safety that are directly related to travelling for abortion or self-inducing abortion. We feel this is unacceptable and that provision must be made in law and policy for accessible high-quality abortion services in Ireland. In order for this to happen, the Eighth Amendment must be repealed. Women in Ireland do experience pregnancies that are unplanned, unwanted, or become a crisis because of a change in circumstances, whether that be social or medical. We don't know exactly how many Irish women have abortions. What we do know is that in 2015, 3,451 women gave Irish addresses when having abortions in UK clinics. We don't know how many gave other addresses or had abortions elsewhere. One online provider provided research in 2016 that 1,642 abortion pill packages had been sent to Ireland between the 1st of January 2010 and December 12. That's only one provider. So women are having abortion in Ireland, but abortion is excluded from mainstream healthcare. This is associated with weak systems which put women's health at risk. So the first problem is that the law locates abortion information provision outside mainline medical consultations and within pregnancy counselling. So while pregnancy counsellors are very good at their job, they go through options available to women, tease out the reason why their pregnancy may be a problem for them and try to help them coming to their decision. If they're presented with a medical issue in the middle of that, they don't feel competent to deal with that. Doctors generally would deal with issues regarding referral of women to other services that they need, but in this situation, they are forbidden from making direct referrals for abortion services, even where they are legal. And secondly, they will feel that because those services are outside of our state and outside of our control, that they may not have sufficient information about them to feel comfortable with referring women there. This moving of women into a different sphere without a proper referral pathway results in a loss of continuity of care. The impacts of travelling on women, firstly, they actually make their decisions under far more pressure than they otherwise would. So most of the worry of the decision is around the financial implications, making the arrangements for the travelling, trying to find out the information about where the abortion clinic is, trying to find somebody to look after your children at home, maybe trying to arrange time off work, rather than just focusing on what is the best thing for me to do in this crisis pregnancy. The procedure they have is going to be decided based on the time they have to spend away. So somebody who has to come and go in one day is going to have a surgical procedure rather than a medical procedure. Globally, the trend is to encourage medical procedures because they have lower complication rates. Pain and bleeding are not necessarily severe. They are normal post-operative effects, but in Irish women, they're occurring in airports, on planes, in taxis, and on buses, rather than at home. If a problem does arise, they're unable to access follow-up care with the abortion provider because they're now back home in Ireland. And all of this tends to cause stigma, where women are made to feel like criminals. Travelling is not an option for everybody. In some cases, it's actually impossible. Somebody simply doesn't have the money or simply can't arrange the practicalities. Migrant women who can't get documents organised in time simply don't get the opportunity to travel. Women who don't have good English are still expected to make appointments by themselves without any assistance. Women with disability or minors are going to have difficulties travelling if they don't have a support person. And as simple a thing as living far away from an airport can be the extra thing that makes it impossible for a woman to access abortion. Not surprisingly, there is a growing trend of self-inducing abortion. The criminal laws do not deter women from seeking abortion, and women from all walks of life are increasingly accessing medication online to self-induce abortion. It's unacceptable that this clandestine self-use of medication is what they seem to feel is their best or maybe only option. And as a healthcare provider, we would not advocate accessing medication in this way in any other circumstance either. So what are the risks of self-inducing abortion? Number one would be that it is more likely to fail if, for example, the gestation has not been estimated accurately by the woman. So if she is in fact a week or two beyond what she thinks she is, it may be more likely that the abortion will not occur. Because some bleeding will frequently occur, she may actually think that it has occurred and only discover weeks later that the pregnancy is continuing. At this stage, her pregnancy has now been exposed to potentially harmful medication. Medication bought online is not always from a reliable source. It may not be genuine, it may be ineffective, or could potentially be harmful. Because the women know that they are breaking the law by taking this, they are fearful of seeking help when problems arise, and this causes, at the very least, anxiety and, at worst, delayed management of complications. Some providers will provide support, but as this is by email, there may be several hours delay between a woman putting a question and getting a response. And nobody in the Irish health system is monitoring women's health outcomes in these situations. So what women need is a health system's approach where access to abortion is integrated into the reproductive healthcare system. How would we develop such a system? There are international health bodies who set standards for all areas of reproductive health care and the practice of obstetrics and gynecology. They rely on medical ethics, expertise, research, and up-to-date medical developments. The Royal College of Obstetrics and Gynecology in the UK, the World Health Organization, and the International Federation of Gynecologists and Obstetricians all have best practice guidelines on abortion provision. The World Health Organization suggests that we first should focus on reducing unintended pregnancy by ensuring access to contraception and sexuality education, ensure timely access to quality assured, affordable abortion services when required, to be sure to meet the needs of disadvantaged women, and that administrative or procedural barriers should not be put in place to make it difficult for women to access services. And services should respect women's reproductive health rights, their dignity, their autonomy, and equality. Looking to Europe, access is a big issue. If you ensure access to good quality services, you end up with lower, not higher, abortion rates. Looking at other countries to see how they have developed practice, one example is Portugal, where the law was reformed 10 years ago, and a law and service provision model has been designed to ensure access to free, early medical abortion. In this service, there's integrated contraceptive information, and this has also lowered their abortion rate in Portugal. So in conclusion, we would feel that the status quo is inequitable and unacceptable. Ireland cannot continue to accept an inherently weak system which is failing women. Access to abortion in Ireland is completely dependent on a woman's resources. Denial, therefore, disproportionately affects disadvantaged women. Unsurprisingly, human rights expert monitoring bodies have called for reform of Ireland's abortion laws, but law reform alone is insufficient to ensure access. Abortion services must be integrated into the reproductive healthcare system. As I've said, there is ample guidance and many useful models from other countries to fall back on to look for guidance in this respect. But repeal of the Eighth Amendment is the vital first step, without which we can't do any of this. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hinchian. Now, our fourth speaker in this session is Patrick Carr on behalf of Family and Life.
Ms. Justice Lafoy, ladies and gentlemen of the Citizens' Assembly, good afternoon. I represent Family and Life and its supporters across the country. I'm joined today by my colleague David Manley, who will be happy to help with the questions later on. We're grateful for the opportunity to make this presentation. We hope it will assist you in your deliberations and help you to see the importance of keeping the Eighth Amendment. I should say that Family and Life has had grave reservations about this process. It has seemed to us that the government's purpose in establishing this assembly was to facilitate a referendum on removing the Eighth Amendment, while at the same time insulating the government from political damage. Despite our reservations, however, Family and Life decided to engage with the Assembly in good faith. We made a submission to the public consultation, which I hope you have had an opportunity to read. This lays out our main arguments for keeping the Eighth Amendment and addresses in greater detail than I can in the time available today the issues which we believe you should take into account as you come to make your final decision. As the process continued, we have been concerned by an apparent lack of balance in some of the presentations at the various sessions. These have included very little material to show the benefits that have been brought by the Eighth Amendment, benefits to mothers, babies, and society generally, on the basis of which a case might be made for keeping the amendment. At the last weekend session, you even had representatives of the abortion industry brought in to address you. You heard from Dr. Patricia Lohr, medical director of Britain's largest abortion business. BPAS made more than £29 million last year, mostly derived from performing abortions, so it is hardly a disinterested party, let alone an impartial expert. You also heard from Gilda Sedge of the Guttmacher Institute, set up as the research branch of Planned Parenthood. The abortion giant to which the IFPA, from whom you've just heard, is affiliated. The Guttmacher Institute's entire purpose is to produce research presenting abortion in a favourable light. But despite all of this, Family and Life has sent me here today because we hope that even now you may be persuaded to stand up for the important human rights at stake, human rights that are seriously threatened by proposals to repeal the Eighth Amendment. Family and Life believes that the Eighth Amendment should be retained because it affirms that the right to life is a fundamental human right belonging to all human beings, born and unborn, and it reaffirms the basic equality of each and every human being. We believe that the Eighth Amendment underpins a medical culture which ensures that pregnant women and their babies receive the best possible care. The amendment affirmed that the unborn child is a human being and consequently is protected by the law. While the word abortion is not mentioned in its text, the main purpose of the amendment, for which the people voted so strongly in 1983, was to prevent the legalization of abortion, either by act of the Oireachtas or by a decision of the Supreme Court. But that is precisely what those who are demanding repeal of the Eighth want. Many have openly stated that they would like an abortion regime like Britain's. This view is reflected in many of the pro-repeal submissions you have received. These were, of course, a minority, and the 70% of citizens who made submissions in favour of keeping the Eighth Amendment unchanged should be acknowledged. It should also be recognised that in the event of the Eighth Amendment being repealed, the Supreme Court, in assessing the constitutional situation, could not simply revert to the 6th of September 1983. Rather, the court would be bound to take account of the fact that the Irish people would have deliberately chosen to strip a particular category of human beings of their rights. A quite extraordinary thing to do, since fundamental human rights are not normally considered something that can be taken away at will, even by a majority vote of the people. The recognition of the importance of human rights is one that has unfolded over centuries. In 1776, the US Declaration of Independence stated that all men are created equal and are endowed with certain inalienable rights, including life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. In 1947, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights spoke of the rights and freedoms to which every human being is entitled, regardless of race, color, sex, language, religion, or other status. In 1983, Ireland affirmed that the unborn child is a human being, to be counted as a member of the human family, sharing in that basic equality and dignity common to all human beings. the Eighth Amendment was a pioneering declaration of the fundamental equality of all human beings, something of which we as a nation should be proud. The unborn child is equal in dignity to his or her mother and father, and indeed to all of us. The amendment recognizes, however, the unique relationship between the unborn child and the mother, and the fact that medical problems can arise during pregnancy. On rare occasions, a medical intervention necessary to save the life of the mother may result in the unintended death of the baby. This was foreseen by the Eighth Amendment, and it was drafted in such a way as to ensure that it could not be used to undermine in any way the mother's right to life. It is a straightforward scientific fact that each one of us began life at conception. Thanks to advances in technology, we now know vastly more about life before birth than ever before. Every cell in your body today has the same genetic code as the single-celled zygote that you once were, and that code determined all the genetic traits, physical and mental, that make up the person you are today and will continue to be until you die. Only in the 20th century, even as our knowledge and understanding of the unborn child grew, did societies begin to decriminalize abortion, initially for hard cases such as rape or incest. In 1967, the British government enacted an abortion law which was intended to be strict with rigorous safeguards against abuse. 50 years later, that legislation is responsible for about 200,000 deaths per year. Killing on such an industrial scale is only possible by the dulling of consciences, by the dehumanization of the unborn child. This is why abortionists refer to the unborn child as just a bunch of cells or a lump of tissue. It is easier to approve the killing of a fetus than that of a baby. Those who think that Ireland could abandon the Eighth Amendment and yet adopt a more restrictive abortion law than Britain's should consider the example of France. The law there contains many of the restrictions that might be proposed as being preferable to the British model, such as a much lower time limit and, until 2015, a mandatory waiting period. And yet, this French law results in an abortion rate which by some measures is even higher than Britain's. If Ireland had an abortion rate comparable to Britain's, that would translate to well over 12,000 abortions every year. And who would perform these abortions? Abandoning the life-affirming culture underpinned by the Eighth Amendment will create great difficulties for many medical professionals. They will face growing pressure to become complicit in actions they believe to be gravely unethical. The need to respect the conscience rights of medical professionals and others should be carefully considered by the Assembly. The basic starting point of the pro-life movement is that the unborn child is a human being, and consequently that abortion is the taking of a human life. This is an assertion based on scientific evidence and is not dependent on any particular religious belief. Family and Life comes before you today as an advocate for the thousands of unborn children who will die as a direct result of your decision if you recommend repealing or eviscerating the Eighth Amendment. I claim no particular expertise, medical or legal, because none is needed to see that killing is wrong. A burning light, as has been said, will shine as brightly even in a child's hand. The choice before you is a straightforward one: life or death. I ask you, please choose life. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Before we go on to the questions and answers, I have to respond to some criticism that was implicit in that last presentation. I'm referring to the presentation by Gilda Sedge, who works for the Guttmacher Institute, and the presentation by Dr. Patricia Lohr from the British Pregnancy Advisory Service, both of whom we heard in February, at the February weekend meeting. And I just want to make it absolutely clear that both of these speakers were invited to present their present in their personal, professional capacity as experts in their respective fields. There was no question of us engaging with, I think the expression was used, the abortion industry. Their invitations were in response to specific requests from members to hear where Ireland's abortion regime sits amongst other developed nations. And as has been repeated, I think, this weekend, Gilda Sedge was the author of a report on research, which was published in The Lancet, very recently. That was what we wanted to hear from her. We wanted to hear the statistics, and that is what she gave us. In relation to Dr. Lohr, the members made it quite clear that they wanted to hear about, from a medic or medics in the United Kingdom, about how the procedure is carried out in the United Kingdom. And that is why Dr. Patricia Lohr was invited to speak, because she had experience and experience of dealing with Irish women. And I want to make it clear that we had signaled fairly early on, I think as far back as January, that we were going this route. I think, and this is my own view, that failure to include this material would have represented a serious omission in the overall work programme. So I just want to make that clear. Now we go on to the questions and answer session, and we have two babies, I see. first of all, Helen Guinan is joining Sinead for Parents for Choice. Dr. Eamon McGuinness is joining, I think. Tracy, is that right? And that's on behalf of Every Life Counts. And I think Niall Behan is from the Irish Family Planning Association is joining Dr. Katrina Hinchin. And Patrick is going to be joined by David Manley, as he said. Yeah, thank you. Very good. The usual rules in relation to the questions. Please, one question. Indicate who you're directing it at, if you're directing it at somebody specific, and if a facilitator is posing a question on behalf of a member, as I've indicated previously, it should be a verbatim record of what the member said. All right, we'll take the first question.
Hi, my name is Fionnuala. I'm a table member over here. Sinead, my question's for you and Helen. You mentioned somewhere around 50% of women in labour have tests or procedures performed without consent in Ireland at the moment. Yesterday, this was described as venturing into medical negligence. Is it the case that nurses, doctors and midwives are potentially committing acts of medical negligence and being allowed to continue to practice specifically because of the Eighth Amendment?
Can you hear me through this? Okay. I would hesitate to describe anything as medical negligence, as that's a specific legal term. What we do know is that the Eighth Amendment is used to coerce women in labour and birth, as we saw in the High Court through the Mother A case and Ms. B, which was quite recently. Ms. B won her case and won her right to bodily autonomy, but the fact that she was brought there at all under the Eighth Amendment is a shame and should never have happened. And the ruling also made clear that there is potential for the Eighth Amendment to apply to further women in birthing situations not being left to have the final choice in what happens to their own body, which is really quite a nightmarish scenario, speaking as someone who has been pregnant and given birth in Ireland.
Sorry, Sinead, just to be clear, I wasn't describing medical negligence to yourself. That was a separate discussion yesterday, not by yourselves. Thank you.
I'm the facilitator on table 14, and a member has asked me to ask a question of Mr. Carr. You opened your speech with a criticism of the Assembly's choice of representatives such as Gilda Seo and Dr. Lohr as of their vested interests. Would you also have issue with previous contributors, Dr. Helen Watt and Donal Mahuna, who would also be considered to have having vested interests in this process?
I think there have been obviously some pro-life perspectives presented to you. However, my concern was with the overall balance of the presentations, and particularly the areas that haven't been covered, and the benefits to Ireland of the Eighth Amendment, and the many good things that have come from it and that ought to be considered in any consideration of how it should be treated in the future, and particularly the important rights of the unborn child, which have tended to be, I think, overall, with some exceptions, but overall, looking at the balance of the presentations, somewhat put in the background at the very least.
I'm the facilitator for Table 13. A member at this table would like the following question to be directed at the representatives of the Family and Life. How could BPAS have a vested interest in a business sense in having the Eighth Amendment repealed if they would consequently lose the business of Irish women with unwanted pregnancies travelling to the UK?
The BPAS have in their, as part of their stated purpose, to increase the proportion of UK abortions that it provides and to become thought leaders in the field of reproductive and sexual health in order to influence public policy. Now, obviously, the BPAS, you might say, has a certain vested interest in ensuring that the numbers of Irish women currently travelling to Britain for abortions would continue to do so. Yet, the fact of the matter is that BPAS is in the abortion business, and promoting abortion and countering any laws that would seek in any way to restrict it, as they are currently campaigning against even the minimal restrictions that exist in British law, is consistent with their general objectives.
Very good. Thank you very much. I think we should take a broader view of this. I think we have had enough questions on BPAS.
Thank you, Judge. I'm the facilitator for Table 3, and a citizen at this table has requested a question to be put to Tracy Harkin. Does Tracy believe that if the ACE was repealed, women would be mandated to terminate pregnancies where life-limiting conditions are present, or would their existing option to continue with their pregnancy still be available to them? Thank you.
Thank you. That's a good question. I think it's many people, you know, we've had this discussion ourselves as parents, where many people would think, well, surely it's just a matter of choice, where those that the main focus should be the establishment of good care, both for women who want to continue their pregnancy, but for those that don't, surely they should be given, the ACE should be repealed to allow them to go through with an abortion. The problem with that is that we can very easily see from what's happened in other countries, we don't have to imagine what the results of legalised abortion would be. For example, I think we also put into our submission that the children with any disability, there's two particular concerns that I would have, I suppose, as a mother of a child with a disability and someone who believes passionately that everyone should be treated equally under the law. And that's when you withdraw protection in law from a certain category of human beings, you know, put whatever label you want on it, the fatal, you know, to dehumanise that child, where it's a fatal abnormality or Down syndrome or whatever. There are many out there, spina bifida, for example. What the reality is that when a mother is given that news, when a parent are given that news at their 18 to 20 week scan that there's something seriously wrong with their child, that what's happened, and this has been, flagged up in what the Bruce Inquiry, a few years ago, would have said that parents are experiencing in those countries where it's totally legal to abort a child with any disability, experiencing real pressure, and negative attitudes are hugely important. And I think that, I suppose, in terms of the medical profession, what we would be advocating is a greater understanding of the conditions of each child. And so that whenever a parent is given a diagnosis, that there's good information there, that the child isn't dehumanized, and that the child is treated with dignity in the way they're spoken about, that the parent is encouraged, you know, to, that the fear sort of can just melt away when parents actually see a child like the one within their womb with the same condition, when they can see that. And so yes, I think that choice becomes very much an expectation, as we can see in Britain, in America, and on all of the other countries, when with protection is withdrawn, it impacts the culture. I mean, there's, when I sort of think, what's so different about Irish culture now in terms of why are there so many babies, for example, with Down syndrome or other disabilities allowed to be born and become, you know, a very important part of our families, of our communities? It's because the law, under the law, they are valued equally from the moment of conception to birth. When that with protection is taken away, of course it impacts the culture to the extent where in Iceland 100% of babies with Down syndrome are terminated. And I mean, I was shocked when I found that out. I think a lot of people are. So that's what we believe passionately, that of course there's a real negative impact, both for parents and their whole experience of diagnosis, and ultimately on the child's right to life and being cherished and valued.
I am the facilitator for Table 5. This question was put to the last panel, and I've been asked to put it to Dr. Henshin. Now, do you see any problem with following the likes of Denmark, whereby they are actively pursuing what appears to be a eugenics policy?
Again, I mean, I heard the response in the last session, and I mean, I think these are complicated situations. Everybody is going to respond differently in the event of being given a diagnosis like that. And I think you have to actually say that the family that's involved, the parents in that situation, have to have the ultimate right to make the decision about what's best for their family. They may already have children who already have special needs that they're struggling to manage. They may have situations where they feel that they would not be able to cope with the situation. And I think we have to respect their decision in that sense.
Thank you very much. Any other questions?
Hi, I'm a member from Table 4. It's to Tracy. You mentioned that we have a great culture in Ireland of supporting or protecting these children with life-limiting conditions under law. I would argue that their birth is protected, but I don't think we really care so much after that. I think our state, our system, our society is not really structured to properly support the parents who bring those children into the world. I think that's worth thinking about.
Yeah, I suppose as a mother with a child with a disability, yes, I think we can always improve, like we can improve all services. But certainly I think that that after birth, I mean, I think you can see certainly in this country that there is just a multitude of support groups, often parent-led, like, for example, Soft Ireland was established by the Fagan family after they had their little daughter, Elaine, who was born with trisomy 18. They started that support to reach out to help other parents. I think the state needs to support that. I think we can do with more, for example, respite care and that. But I think that what I've seen with my daughter is just an outpouring of support for her, and people just willing to fundraise, to do whatever they can. I think these children bring something special to our communities, to our families. They're just loved. They just give love in abundance. And of course, I don't sugarcoat the reality of caring for a child like Kathleen. She is tube fed. She, every 3 to 4 months, she takes chest infections. But she goes to special school most days. She's just a little joy, and she, I would say she is at the heart of our home. She's had a very positive impact on our other siblings as well. And yes, I always would be advocating for better services and better support. I think that's something that's important, whether it's in the field of health, generally the field of education, certainly in terms of services for children with disabilities. But I think that many parents, as I said, with children that have been born with special needs have actually got quite advanced in this country in terms of the support that there is for them. Well, of course, there could be improvements, yes, and we need to work on that.
Thank you. Another question?
Hi, how are you? I'm a member from Table 5. This is more of a comment than a question. Just in relation to family and life, referring to it as abortion business, you have in your paper that BPAS had an income of more than £29 million in 2015. It might also be worth noting that the income exactly was £29,079, whereas expenditure was £29,438, which is a standalone deficit of £359.
Would you like to make a comment on that?
I stand over what I said. It's £29 million, I think, not thousand. And it's a very substantial interest that company has in the promotion of abortion.
Very good. Thank you very much.
It's a question for either of the two men from Family and Life. So, Family and Life advocates for the pro-life movement. I was just curious as to what work do Family and Life do to advocate for families or children in dire social or economic circumstances, or where the child is disabled and they need extra support. So what work do they do to ensure that they're advocated for and to ensure that they enjoy a good quality of life within Irish society?
Family and Life is aware as of the shortcomings of the Irish health system and the lack of facilities both before birth and after birth, and for those with children who have disabilities. But these are practical problems. These are problems which can be solved. They can be solved with a goodwill from the government, from those who vote in ministers and vote in TDs. They are the people who can make the decisions to finance the improvements that has been called for by other speakers. But the problem is not what you asked so much, but what it was left hanging in the air. And that is this: the easy solution, the convenient solution, especially for governments that are looking at the balancing of the books, is to get rid of the disabled children before birth. And that is the thing that Family and Life is standing against. These children have human dignity. And whether it is difficult, and I have no doubt it is most difficult for parents with disabled children, but whether or not that is what we should do to be human beings ourselves.
Thank you. Another question?
Can I respond?
No, we'll...
Well, it's just a follow-on. Explicitly, does Family and Life do any work to advocate for families and children in dire social and economic circumstances? And if they don't, would it not be fair to say that you're more of a pro-birth organisation than a pro-life organisation?
It's certainly not the case that our concerns are exclusively limited to the unborn. A number of the projects that we engage in are of a more wide-ranging in their scope. There's, for instance, a project that provides practical assistance to women in crisis pregnancy situations, and that can be all manner. It's tailored to their specific needs, and the assistance can continue beyond birth. There's also another project, a project that we fund overseas that takes children who have been abandoned off the streets and provides them with an education, provides for their practical needs and the other needs that they may have. So our concern is with the vulnerable generally. We have a particular interest in the rights of the unborn, but our concerns for the rights of all vulnerable people and their dignity extends beyond that.
Very good. Thank you very much. Another question?
I'm the facilitator for Table 6. One of the members of this table have a question for Family and Life. Do Family and Life respect the fact that the people who have presented to the Assembly to date were requested to do so by the members who sit here today?
Most certainly, I respect the sincerity and the goodwill of all the speakers here. I'm not suggesting in any way that it is that they have special interests or anything that would lessen their credibility. And I respect also, of course, the wishes and the requests of the Citizens' Assembly. After all, you are the people that have invited me, and thank you for that. So I hope that answers your question. But once again, I would say that the reason I came here is that I know, as a scientific fact, that the unborn is the same as the born, a human being. And that is the, if you like, the stumbling block for saying, well, we can have a little abortion or we can relax the law as it is at present, get rid of the Eighth Amendment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll take one final question now. Does anybody want to?
Hi, this is to Family and Life. It's just a clarification of a point made by my colleague. BPAS is in fact a non-profit registered charity.
All right, I don't want to go there anymore. I think...
have we another 5 minutes?
We do. Yeah, does anybody want to ask any other question?
Could I respond to a point?
All right.
We mentioned in our presentation that we've had contacts, and it's something that you guys have raised, which is understandable. And we've had contacts from parents of children with Down syndrome. And of course, there's been a lot of concern raised in this debate about what happens to children with Down syndrome. I'd like to just read out one of their submissions very briefly in their own words, as they feel really underrepresented, and it was really important for us to give them a voice here, if that's okay with you. It's very brief. This is from my friend Linda, who's also a member of Parents for Choice, Linda Delmar from Dublin. My son is called Shay. He's 5 years old. He has Down syndrome. Shay is loved and cherished by everyone around him. I find the use of pictures of children with Down syndrome in the pro-life campaign to be deeply upsetting. It implies that given the choice, I would have chosen to abort him. That because of Shay's Down syndrome, I would love him a little less. That he is not worthy of the love we have for him because he's not deemed to be perfect. In this country that cherishes the children, Shay is treated like a second-class citizen. We fight for access to adequate healthcare. We battle every day to receive appropriate support from services. He has just completed his psychological assessment to see if he has Down syndrome enough to warrant full support in the school system. No parent should have to go through this. No child should have to go through this. In Ireland, this is what we do to the families who choose to keep their imperfect child. It is an insult to Shay and his tribe and to their families and friends to use Down syndrome in a pro-life campaign. Shay is perfect. Shay is our choice. Thank you, Linda, for letting us use your words. Thank you for listening.
Yes, thank you for that, because again, that's in Sinead's presentation, as she said, and she's read it out. I would urge you all again to read the papers on the presentations, but also, and I'm stressing this again, also read the submissions which all of the groups and the organisations have gone to a lot of trouble of putting before us. They're online and as I say, I urge you to read them. I want to express gratitude on behalf of the members to all of our four speakers today and to our additional answerers, some of whom didn't get an opportunity to speak, but in any event, I'm very grateful to all of you, and we will benefit from your contribution. Thank you very much.